Harvard Yard to Beacon Hill. That's not a great distance, but two very different worlds. Could an Ivy League professor make the leap to the governor's office? Danielle Allen is here this morning to talk about a likely run. Let's go on the record.
From WCVB Channel 5, the inside word from Washington to Beacon Hill. Today's newsmakers are going on the record.
Welcome to OTR on this last Sunday in May. I'm Ed Harding, along with News Center 5's political reporter Janet Wu. Hope you're enjoying the holiday weekend, given the fact that the weather isn't so good. So joining us in studio this morning is Danielle Allen. She has made the study of politics and democracy the focus of her professional life. She's currently at Harvard. She is very, 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 like, this close to announcing a run for governor in 2022. In fact, if you'd like to say it right now, Danielle, you're more than welcome to say it right now. But thanks for being here.
Great to be here. Thank you.
Good morning. Thanks for joining us. So let's just ask you the obvious question. Why are you running, and why for the top political job of the state instead of, well, for example, building a base first?
It's the pandemic that brought me here. I just had such a deep sense of shock when it hit last winter at how easy it was for some people in our society more or less to imagine abandoning others. You'll remember that loose talk back last winter about, for example, older people. Oh, it's just their time. Let's just keep the economy open. We don't need to worry about protecting them. That just seemed to me deeply wrong, and as did the way we pushed essential workers back so aggressively without access to testing and PPE. So I jumped in. I did a huge amount of COVID work, really built the first national policy roadmap, advocating for accelerated ramp up of investment in testing and contact tracing. Those are policies that have ended up in various ways in the Biden-Harris COVID response. And as I did that work, I also had the chance to work here in Massachusetts at the state level and in other states around the country. And that gave me a really clear window into the good work we could and should be doing to lay a foundation of flourishing for everybody by focusing on the basics of social infrastructure, how housing, health, education, jobs, and justice fit together. We left people behind, we left people out, people are disconnected. It shouldn't be that way in our prosperous state. And I believe as we pass through this crisis, this is the moment for us to do that work of laying a foundation of flourishing for everybody.
When do you plan to announce?
Not there yet. This is an exploratory phase. We've got very specific indicators that we're tracking to make the judgment about whether or not it makes sense to go forward. So a few more weeks before we have all the information that we need.
Let's drill down on what you were just saying. You were critical of the governor's handling of the pandemic, although I think you would agree he certainly redeemed the public's trust with his vaccine distribution system. Or maybe you don't agree. So let me ask you that. Do you agree or not with that statement that he has redeemed the public's trust with his vaccination distribution system?
Well, you know, the thing I think that really matters about the vaccine distribution is the way in which civil society organizations stepped in and made a critical difference. So look at the Black Boston COVID Coalition really getting vaccines into arms for communities of color in the Boston area. And look at the Berkshire County Collaborative on vaccines. They too pulled together a network in the county to fill in a gap when the state wasn't actually delivering. Mm-hmm. I think that's a model. Civil society can show us where the solutions are. We need a state administration that looks for those solutions coming from civil society, doesn't have to be dragged into seeing them.
Is the public wrong in believing that the trust in its vaccine distribution system is working? Is that a misperception?
I'm sorry, I didn't quite catch that. Do you mind?
Is it a misperception that the public's trust with its vaccine distribution system is working, or is it indeed working? What do you think?
You know, we're all so happy to have vaccines. I am too. I just got my second shot on Sunday. We could not be more grateful for the fact that we have this powerful tool for suppressing the disease. We are so grateful for the work of Moderna, for the work of Pfizer and the like. There were a lot of bumps in the road on that vaccine distribution. Yes, the state corrected, and that is a terrific thing. We have lots to be grateful for. At the same time, there are other parts of COVID response that also matter. The unemployment insurance system, the website there, the interface with users, hasn't had the same degree of responsiveness as the vaccine system has had. And I think there's where we see the important pattern, that some folks in this state have really gotten the protection and support and connection to security they need, and others haven't. And that's what we really need to look at plainly right now, and I believe do hard work, good work to address.
Let's talk about the criminal justice system. You've had some personal experiences with it. What changes are you advocating, and should the police be defunded or their budgets at least dramatically cut?
I think we are at a moment in time where we need to reimagine safety. We need to recognize that safety should be something that all have access to, and that safety is about communities being healthy, communities having access to housing and to mental health resources. I do think we need things like alternative dispatch systems that connect people to mental health resources when needed, rather than connecting them straight to a policing response. So I think we have a lot of work to do. There's a lot of work to do reimagining safety, absolutely.
And you did have a relative that was a victim of the system, was it not correct?
Yes, I lost a baby cousin, my baby cousin Michael, in 2009. I mean, he was not a baby when we lost him. He was 30, but he had been incarcerated at the age of 15 on a first arrest for an attempted carjacking. He served 12 years, and when he got out, I was, as I always call myself, the cousin on duty. So helping with housing and jobs and school, trying to reconnect him to the family, put the floor back under him so we could take him forward with all of us. And then 2 years after he was first released, he was killed by somebody he met while he was in prison. That was just a devastating moment for my whole family, as I'm sure you can imagine.
You write and talk a lot about bridging the differences between parties who disagree. Congress is an obvious example of this. If Democrats make more concessions, do you believe that Senator Mitch McConnell will do the same to get President Biden's infrastructure bill passed?
It's good that the Republicans are engaged in conversations about infrastructure. Right now, they're pretty far distance from the place that we actually need. So I continue to hope, and the hope I have really comes from the fact that the country and the spread of opinion in the country is actually quite different from what we see in the operations of our parties in Washington. So I think the Biden administration is doing the right thing in advocating to the country as a whole, seeking broad support across party lines for with ordinary voters. And at this point, we do see often ordinary voters out of sync with the Republican Party. Look at the Trump tax cut, for example. The party went for that, but Republican voters weren't actually even supportive of that. So Biden recognizes that split between the party and ordinary people, and I think he's doing well to build on that.
And you think that, you honestly believe that the Republicans will come to the table with more concessions?
There's work in progress. A lot of people are working really hard. I think we all know where we want to get, and let's hope we get there.
The biggest problem facing Massachusetts right now is affordable housing, as you pointed out a little bit earlier. But the most immediate crisis you would face as governor is the MBTA and transportation. What's your fix?
I think we have a huge opportunity right now. This actually speaks to the last question as well. The Biden infrastructure plan gives us a chance to really invest in our transportation infrastructure in the Commonwealth as a whole. If we do that, that also gives us the chance perhaps to make some adjustments in our revenue and expense allocations such that we can invest in housing too. Housing and transportation are critical parts of infrastructure. You have to have a successful nexus of those things to open up opportunity. I think it's time that we recognize that we are the third most densely populated state in the country, but we have an antiquated transportation system. We need a transportation system, a public transportation system, that's up to the challenge of a place as densely populated as we are.
Well, as you know, they ordered and put into use these new Orange Line cars that apparently are not doing a very good job. I mean, what's the problem there and what would you do to fix it?
There's no question that we've had struggles for quite a period of time with management at the MBTA. And at the end of the day, when we do this kind of work, it really does depend on the people that you have in place. And so you have to have really robust processes for helping people work towards strategic vision, helping them then also lay out that implementation plan for deliverables and the like. I've seen an absence of strategic vision in the work of the MBTA. And then I think when you don't have that in place, it makes it actually much harder to hold people accountable for the things you need them to deliver.
Well, and then that begs the question, how do you get there? You know what I mean? It's taken a number of governors have tried and it just hasn't happened.
Well, absolutely. I mean, there's a lot to learn from the past experiences, but I think what we really need actually is intense work on collective, Commonwealth-wide strategic visioning around transportation. We've seen some good work in some of our regional transit authorities. So for example, the Worcester Transportation Authority, I think has done great work over the course of the pandemic. And I don't see the same quality of strategic planning work happening in the context of the MBTA. So I think we have to build on strength where we see successes build up from there. Take the example from that and develop that strategic plan that's Commonwealth-wide.